Stephen Gurney O'Maigod of his Fáilteach Fia Roimh Thig on Henshaw. You're all very welcome to this talk on the Irish language. Irish language, 2,000 years old. I've got about 15 minutes to talk about it. So in other words, you're going to get what we call in Irish a blashu. Blashu means a little dip in, because I couldn't possibly do the language any kind of credence inside such a short period of time. Irish is basically a Celtic language, belongs to the Celtic family of languages, and is related to the Gaelic of Scotland and the Manx of the Isle of Man. Those three languages are very similar to each other, and I'll come back to them later on. And then on the other side we have Cornish, Welsh and Breton. Breton is the language of northwest France or Brittany. Where did the name come from? The name comes from basically from the Greeks. They called this group of people the Celtoi, and then the Romans called them Celti, and they're not to be called Celts or Celtic. It's simply Celti, Celtoi, and Celtic. They emerged as a distinct group in the 5th century BC, and they spread westwards throughout Europe. And they came to Britain and Ireland sometime about 400 years BC. They were very powerful, they were very much feared. They sacked Rome in the year 390 BC, and they also sacked Delphi in Greece in 279 BC. However, as Roman influence started to spread throughout the rest of Europe, Celtic independence was basically started to wane, and by the 2nd century AD, the Celts had more or less disappeared from mainland Europe and were restricted to basically Ireland and to parts of Britain. Julius Caesar, we all know from, say for example, from Shakespeare, Julius Caesar wrote about the Celts. He called them actually Gauls, and he has a book or a series of books, or probably war diaries you call them nowadays, called De Bello Gallico, where he outlines what happened in Gaul, and Gaul is basically nowadays modern France. It's probably from Gaul that Charles de Gaulle got his surname. The first evidence we have of the Celts or Irish speakers in Ireland is witnessed on tombstones. Basically, most of these are found in southwest Munster, particularly in Cork and Kerry, and Waterford. They're actually standing stones in which there are notches or dots cut out into the stone. It's called oam or ugam, and it would indicate that early settlements in Ireland were not in the north, because in the north we basically only have about 8 stones altogether. Probably the most famous one is the one in Armagh, which is called the Drumconwell Oam Stone. It's in the Diocesan Library in Armagh. And Drumconwell is a townland going from Armagh out towards Navan, Navan Fort. And you imagine, yeah, because of the fact that Navan Fort has been there for a long time, or Alan Waha has been there for a long time, that there you would imagine or you expect to find an oam stone from that area. Unfortunately, the oam stones don't tell us very much, because they're basically tombstones. So they say something like son of or daughter of. They don't tell us very much else. So it's nearly impossible to figure out what kind of language was used at that particular period. The use of writing, the use of the Roman alphabet, came to Ireland with the arrival of Christianity. Some people say that the Christians, and it's because of Christianity that we have all our bothers and troubles nowadays, that they let us alone, they would have been all right. And there's a Donegal writer who points this out in a novel, that it was Christianity which brought some of the troubles that we nowadays have. Anyway, be that as it may, Christianity came to Ireland. It took several centuries for it to become established in Ireland. We're told that St. Patrick came in 432. Which St. Patrick's are the first one and the second one, or maybe even the third one. But as St. Patrick came in 432, it took several centuries for the religion that he brought to be accepted totally by the people of Ireland. And even in the in the 9th century, we get a poet writing, Christianity is lovely, but paganism also was nice. So we're still kind of hankering after the paganism. Anyway, the evidence we have of the language that Patrick and the monks and the people of the time used is found in glosses that we, basically not so much in this country, but as you know, the monks went abroad. They went to France, they went to Spain, they went to Italy, they went to Germany, they established monasteries, or they became part of monasteries. And in these monasteries, many of them wrote tracts or treatises on the Irish language, or commentaries on Latin, or commentaries on the Gospels, and so on. And we call these glosses. And probably some of the most famous glosses are, for example, the Würzburg glosses in Germany. And Würzburg is associated with Killian. Or St. Gallen glosses in Switzerland. And St. Gallen is associated with Gaul. And very often, as I say, it is bits of commentaries or little bits of poetry which are written on the side of manuscripts, and from them we can actually figure out the content or the type of language that was spoken by these early Christians. I just look at some of these words. These are words that came from Latin into Irish, and as you can see, in many cases also came into English. Litera gives you lecture, letter. Scola gives you skull, or school. Scribit gives you scrivinche, meaning he writes. Liber gives you lore, or book. So as you can see from the first four examples there, the type of words that came into Irish were words dealing with education, words dealing with learning. Then words like ecclesia give you aglish, or church, or in English, ecclesiastical. Or if you think of the town, the place name, eglish, very, very common. Then you get the word episcopus, giving you aspug, or bishop, or episcopal, as we have in English. And then cathedra, giving you cathedra, or chair. So words associated with religion. Obviously, there was no such thing as sin in Irish until the Christians came, or we didn't have the concept, because the word for sin comes from Latin. Peccatum gives us pacca, sin. And of course, with sin comes hell. So from Latin, we get infernus in Latin, ifrin in Irish, and hell in English. So that's one example of where Christianity introduced a series of words into Irish, which obviously had not been there before. Or if they had been there before, they fell out of use simply because of the rise and success of the monastic settlements. An example of a piece of poetry which refers to this time is this Inchen Big, or the Little Bird, composed sometime in the 1800s, we think. It's a poem in praise of the blackbird, because the blackbird is always with us. And you think of, for example, the Seamus Heaney Centre of Poetry in Queens. If you look at their head notepaper, there's a blackbird on it. Because Heaney was very much given to the blackbird. And I'll just read you Heaney's translation of that. The small bird chirp chirrut, yellow neb, and note spurt. Blackbird over laggin water. You can see Loch Lee. That's out there. That piece of water that we have out the back. Blackbird over laggin water, clumps of yellow wind burst. Seamus Heaney's translation of The Little Bird. I'm not here to proselytize or to advertise, but there's a very good CD, Songs of the Scribe, by a woman called Páirceann Ní Uilleán. And it deals, what she has done is she's taken some of the poetry of this early period right into the Middle Ages, and she's put it to music. And it's a very worthwhile CD to listen to. Another example would be The Gloaming, which was on in Queens on Saturday night. They likewise have taken some of this poetry and put it to music. I mentioned earlier on about Scottish Gaelic and Manx. It was during this early period that the North Antrim Kingdom of Dalriada, and I noticed Dalriada or Dalriada was on the news yesterday in that they're closing a hospital or they're cutting back services or something, and people were protesting about the cutbacks. The Kingdom of Dalriada established a settlement in Scotland. Now Scotland at that time was Pictish speaking. Pictish is a language we don't know a huge amount about, but they were there from about the year 500. Then of course you had, going to Scotland, they brought their language with them, which was Irish. Then of course we had Colin Kill going to Scotland in 563, which enhanced the presence of Irish, or the speaking of Irish in Scotland. And by the year 843, the Picts and the Irish speaking were the Scots. Now, Scots actually comes from the word Scotty, and Scotty is a Latin word meaning pirates, marauders, raiders, and so on. Now, do we tell anybody from Scotland that basically that's they come from a crowd of pirates? But anyway, by 843, the Picts and the Irish or the Scots had become settled down together. And by the year, by the 11th century, Irish was basically the spoken language in Scotland. Then, towards the end of the 11th century, the Scottish king, Mícheál Ó Máirtín MacDonaghan, he married a woman called Margaret of Essex, or Wessex rather, and English was introduced to this, introduced into the Scottish throne, and over a period of time, English became the dominant language, so that nowadays when we look at Scotland, the Scottish Gaelic, as we call it, is more or less restricted to the western islands and to the highlands. And census forms say that there are about maybe 70,000 Scottish speakers or speakers of Scottish in Scotland nowadays. Scottish also, by the way, is still spoken on the Cape Breton island in Nova Scotia in Canada, simply because a lot of these people were cleared in the 19th century. We had the clearances to make room for sheep, and a lot of these people left Scotland, went to Canada, and they brought their language with them. While the Irish language was extended the sphere of influence in Scotland and in the Isle of Man, which had been conquered by the king of the Uli. Uli is the old name for Ulster. Sometime in the 6th century, the Norsemen, or the Vikings, were making their presence felt. We know the first Viking raid took place in 795. We know the Vikings were in Dublin in 841. Some of the words that the Vikings introduced, words dealing with seafaring, for example, akkeri, ankere, anchor, words dealing with money, mal, mal, tax, or marketer, market. So words dealing with the seafaring, words dealing with monies, some words dealing with buildings, vinbag to become finyog, lock become lockdown, and this one here, bjor, given as bjor, and it wasn't Carlsberg. So they obviously introduced beer into the country. So the Christians brought in sin, the Vikings brought in beer. No wonder we are as confused as we are. A poem written in the 9th century and sitting on a manuscript in St. Gallen in Switzerland talks about the Vikings. Is Acher and Gri a Nacht, for Fusna Farigat Finfolt, ni Agar Rem Mora Mind, Don Lach Lechre Lan O Lochlin. Bitter and wild is the wind tonight, tossing the tresses of the sea to white. On such a night as this, I feel at ease. Fierce Norsemen only course the quiet seas. So obviously the Norse, the Vikings, had a bit of cop on, and they, if the weather was bad, they stayed at home. We talk nowadays about embedded journalists. There was, during the 13th, 14th century, a number of these. There's one guy called Geraldus Cambrensis, or Gerald of Wales, and he points out in his diaries, or his description of Ireland, that it was from the Norse we learned how to use the axe. So not only did it introduce us to beer, but also taught us how to fight a bit better. Some Viking names that you might come across. Michael D. Higgins, for example. The word Higgins, if you look at it, in Irish it's U-I-G-I-N-N, which, and just look at, look at that, even visually, it looks like Viking. McLaughlin, McManus, O'Higgin, Doyle, McAuliffe, Reynolds, and so on. Look at some of the place names that we have. You've got Strangford, you've got Carlingford, you've got Dalkey, you've got Cork, Dublin, Howth, Wexford, Waterford, Limerick, Galway, Helvig, Schmerwick. I could go on and on and on. So not only did they influence the actual language, they also had an influence on place names, in the sense that they established quite a few of these places, and also they had an influence on surnames as well. The Vikings were, of course, they were defeated at the Battle of Clontarf in 1014, the country seemed to settle down into a certain sense of peace until the arrival of the Anglo-Normans. Now, I call them Anglo-Normans, people talk about the Normans, but they weren't all Normans. Basically, the leaders were Normans and the foot soldiers were English. Basically, the leaders were French-speaking or Norman-speaking. The foot soldiers were not Norman-speaking. A lot of them were English-speaking. A lot of them would have been Welsh-speaking. We know they came in the 12th century. And their influence on the Irish language is very, very important. Words, for example, dealing with government. Conte, Burgesh, Sherbish, then words dealing with architecture, palace, chambre, bagun, widgil, words dealing with food, bagun, widgil, plata, dinner, shukra, supper, and then words dealing with clothes, guna. So the brought into Irish words which dealt with administration, words with dealt with architecture, and if, for example, you're travelling in the southwest part of the country, if you're travelling, for example, in Munster, you'll notice the number of old Norman castles, which are still there, because they tended to stay in the southern part of the country because the weather was better, the countryside was better, and so we get words like palace, chambre, bagun, and then words dealing with food, widgil, plata, dinner. So if we eat too much, it's all because of the Normans. So we take it right back again. The Christians introduce us to sin, the Vikings introduce us to beer, and the Normans introduce us to the food. It's not our fault, we are the way we are. A poet writing sometime later, this would have been now sometime in the 17th century, talked about the Normans, and he says, the Vader Queen Shivilta Trehach, but why unleash a gradu is a messy? God didn't a dulig, the V a hudge hen lesh, the Vader Cancer Marchion Clara, the Hilary a Will Trina Kiela, the V and Gael Galde is and Gael Gaelach. Basically, they were gentle, civilized, and talented. Their laws, religion, and manners were good. This is in reference to the Normans. Anyone who submitted held on to his property. As ecclesiastical leaders, they were gentle. They intermarried, and the Irishman was English, and the Englishman Irish. In fact, the Normans, and it's from the Normans we get the phrase, more Irish than the Irish themselves. From the Normans we get some number of surnames, and most of these are actually found in the southwestern part of the country. Fitzpatrick, Fitzgerald, Fitzmaurice, Fitzgibbon, Darcy, Hussey, Butler, Blennerhassett, Prendergast, Taff, Devereux, Roche, Molyneux. You think of Jim Molyneux, the former leader of the Unionist Party. Must have been some kind of a connection. And I think if you look back, there was a connection with Kerry at one stage between his ancestors, that they came from Southwest Ireland to Northern Ireland at some stage. Such was the state of assimilation, because the Normans actually, you know, espoused the Irish language and Irish ways and so on, that by the year 1500, the Irish language had more or less taken over from French. There was very little French spoken except among maybe some of the ruling class. And basically, the Normans, as I said, had become more Irish than the Irish themselves. They had settled down. And they were seen as a threat by the authorities in London, because they were starting to exert their, you know, their position, and they were looking for certain rights, and why should they be governed by this distant government in London, and you know, we are quite able to look after ourselves. So there are a number of measures to kind of, if you like, discourage the use of Irish, to discourage the Normans from becoming as Irish as they had become. You had the Statutes of Kilkenny in 1366, or you had a letter from Henry VIII to the town of Galway in 1536, where he says, put forth your child to school to learn to speak English. Then after that, we had certain, you know, political upheavals of the 17th century. We had the Battle of Kinsale, we had the Cromwellian settlement, we had the Williamite campaign, we had the enactment of the penal laws. And basically what happened was that the Irish aristocracy became replaced by, or displaced by, an English-speaking aristocracy. A poem, and we're not too sure of the date of this one, some people do think it did say what belonged to the 16th century, but if you look at the actual language in it, it couldn't possibly belong to the 16th century. It's a poem which refers to the demise of the great family of the Butlers. You know, Butler's chocolate, you've seen in the airport and places like that. The Butler family from Clonmel in County Tipperary. Again, this will be put to music, and it's called Kilcash. Kalianwich fasted ganamud, the Gerald na gulche ar lar, neil tractor Kilcash na ar chowlog, is ni bwinher a cling gobrach. An aich ud a gunoi an javan, for gradin is meyer har vrav, veil eerly a tarinch har tinnon, is an tafrin bean arab. Kilcash. What would we do for timber? Now, timber, it's an allegorical sense, it's not just simply trees. With the last of the wood laid low, there's no talk of Kilcash or its household, and its bell will be struck no more. That dwelling where lived the good lady, most honoured and joyous of women, earls made their way over wave there, and the sweet mass once was said. Or, if we look at the words of Davy O'Brother, a poet from Munster. His work actually was researched and edited and published much later by a man from Belfast called Michael Lane, who became a lecturer in UCD in Dublin. And his work is said to be, that is, the work of Davy O'Brother, or the poetry of Davy O'Brother, is said to be one of the best comments or commentaries on the social life of Ireland during this period. Daitle na villu, daitle na villu an nusil, trus an tibul an trail, clan na nulu gunagna, follow gan fragle fwir, daitle na villu dar onwus egshis ul, is marig da honrk an kinu a jiri guin. The high poets are gone, and I mourn for the world's waning. The sons of those learned masters, emptied of sharp response. After those poets for whom art and knowledge were wealth, alas, to have lived to see this fate befall us. Bemoaning the ending of the big houses which were the patrons of the poets, big houses had been, they had become dispossessed, or they had left to go and fight armies, and for example, fight in the Austrian army, or fight in the French or Spanish armies. and the houses had been deserted. And once they left, the poets, the scholars of the time, had nobody to sustain them. And this is the point that's been made by David O'Bruder. So we're into a period of decline in the 17th, 18th centuries. Now, I don't want to give the impression that nothing was happening, that simply Irish language was dying off and there was no kind of movement, if you like. I'll just give you an example of some things which had actually, some things that took place. For example, 1571, we had O'Kearney's Catechism. It's the first book to be commercially printed in Ireland, or in Irish one, 200 copies. It was printed at the behest of Elizabeth I. It was a Protestant catechism. So that's the first printed book we have. I think there are three copies of it still remaining, one in a library in Oxford, and I can't remember where the other two are. Then 1611, we had the first Catholic catechism produced by a man called O'Hosa. Then 1634, we had the Forest Fasser or Erin, or Keating's History of Ireland, as it is called, which is an attempt, I think, to counteract the kind of thing of Stanleyhurst and Gerald of Wales were writing in English about the Irish. I think Keating was trying to prove that we were civilised, that we did have a background, that we did descend from Noah of the Ark, that we had a history of our own. It was a counter-attack against, I think, Stanleyhurst and Gerald of Wales. 1685, we had William Bedell's translation of the Old Testament. He was a rector in Trinity College in Dublin. Then in the 17th century, we had An Bunan Bui, or the Yellow Bittern, the song, the poem which became a song. And the Yellow Bittern, if you were travelling between Inniskillen to Leitrim, there is a lake on the right-hand side of the road called Loch Hain, and that's where the Yellow Bittern is supposed to be found dead. The poet is lamenting the fact that the bittern died because he couldn't get a drink. And here the poet is dying because he needs a drink as well. But it's a different type of drink. Then in the 18th century, we had the song or the poem Urkel a Cragan, which is one of the Aisling poems of the 18th, 19th century. Aisling poetry was a kind of poetry where the poet saw Ireland as a beautiful woman who had been, raped or usurped or taken away by this boor, the boor being England, and where the poet is either looking, the northern poets are looking for the O'Neills of Tyrone to come back and to save Ireland. The southern poets are looking for, they're looking for Bonnie Prince Charles to come back, or the Stuarts to come back and save Ireland. Then in 1773, we have Kinu Archie Leary, or the Lament of Art O'Leary. Art O'Leary was an officer in Austro-Hungarian Empire in the army. When he came back, he continued to wear his officer's uniform. It wasn't a good idea, because that wasn't just what the authorities wanted. Also, he owned a horse, and the horse was valued at more than £5. And at that stage, a Catholic was not allowed to hold a horse more than £5, and he was supposed to give the horse up. And I think he rubbed the Sheriff of Cork's nose in a wrong way, and he was eventually shot. Then we have Charlotte Brooke's Reliquies of Irish Poetry, 1789. She would be an ancestor of Sir Basil Brooke, Lord Brookborough. And then we have in the latter part of the 18th century, Curtin Vanni here, or Brian Merriman's Midnight Court. So, in case you get the impression I'm saying that the 17th, 18th centuries were barren, they were not. There were plenty of things happening, but the language was in decline. If you look at the census returns from 1811, 1851, 1891. 1811, the country is mostly black. That means Irish speaking. The white parts are the English speaking areas. 1851, you can see the country is kind of half and half. 1891, you can see that the black bits are restricted to the western seaboard. and to certain areas in the north, for example, bits around South Derry, Tyrone, Glens of Antrim, South Armagh, North Louth, and so on. So basically what happened in the 19th century, from 1811 to 1891, there was a language shift. Why was there a language shift? Why did a nation abandon one language and take on another one? What happened to the Irish psyche, which made it change from being Irish-speaking to be basically English-speaking? As well as the Act of Union of 1801, when it was eventually got through, because remember there were two attempts to get that through, I suppose it cemented Ireland's place in the Anglophone world, cemented Ireland's place in the British Empire, and English was the dominant language in that empire. The national schools, which were established in 1831, they encouraged the teaching and the learning of Irish, or learning of English rather. And the national schools, many of these schools were actually handed over to church authorities, either to the Roman Catholic Church or Church of Ireland, and the local pastor, the local rector, the local priest was entrusted with the handing on of education in that particular area. A poem the children had to learn in some areas after the establishment of the national schools runs something like this. I thank the goodness and the grace that on my birth has smiled and made me in these Christian days a happy English child. Right. Also at that stage there was a national curriculum brought in by the British, which was the first time there had been any kind of formalised, you know, set of areas to be studied in school, and English was the medium of study. Many national figures, many religious figures, preferred to use English than Irish. Daniel O'Connell, for example, very rarely used Irish, even though he was an Irish speaker, coming from Derrynan in West Kerry. Of course, then you had famines, you had emigration, and you eventually had, I think, the Irish language being associated with a kind of backwardness, a kind of remoteness, a kind of lack of prosperity. And basically, if you wanted your kids to do well, well, they had to be able to speak English, because it was an English-speaking world. There were every chance they would have to go to England or America or Canada, and if they couldn't speak English properly, then they would be in difficulty. So I think there are a number of reasons, you know, political, religious, the educational, the fact that the country was ravaged by famine and ravaged by immigration. All this contributed to the fact that gradually, between 1811 and 1891, there was this massive shift from an Irish-speaking country, basically, to an English-speaking country. Belfast was known as the Athens of the North in the 19th century. In Belfast, we had such places as the Linenhall Library, the Natural History and Philosophical Society, the Belfast Literary Society, the Irish Heart Society, Belfast Academical Institution. Middle-class Protestants were the driving force behind this kind of revival. One of the major players was a man called Robert McAdam, and his name is retained in, for example, Culturland MacAdam Ophi, that is the cultural centre on the Falls Road. But have a look at a quick glance at some of the things that were happening in the 18th, 19th century, just to give you a taste of what was going on. 1782, RIA, Royal Irish Academy, set up in Dublin. 1792, the Belfast Harp Festival, which took place here in Belfast, around St. George's Church in May Street. Right.
High Street.
High Street. And then you had the Gaelic Society of Dublin set up. Then you had the Nation newspaper set up by Thomas Davies. Now, this is, and very interestingly, this is the first time that a distinction was drawn between a national identity, territory, and language. Here's a very interesting thing to say. A people without a language of its own is only half a nation. A nation should guard its language more than its territories. It was a very interesting thing for somebody from his background to say in the middle of the 19th century. Then you had the Oceanic Society set up. Then you had the Chair of Celtic and Queens established in 1860, the first year of the world of students. That doesn't surprise me because students don't turn up to classes anyway. And I think there were, for a number of years, a small number of students in that class. 1868, the Irish National Teachers Organisation set up by a landlord from County Louth. 1876, the Society for the Preservation of the Irish Language. Then 1878, we had Irish being introduced as a subject in schools. 1879-1880, we had the Gaelic Journal. Then 1892, we had Douglas Hyde's famous essay, The Necessity for De-Anglicising Ireland. Again, along the same lines as Thomas Davis said about language is more important than territory. And then 1895, we had the setting up of a branch of the Gaelic League in Naturalist Field Club Society and, on the Bearsbridge Road. Now, they were just some of the things that were happening in the 18th and 19th centuries. In 1921, partition, two states set up, both suspicious and antagonistic towards each other. One was basically Catholic, the other one was Protestant, and they had two, if you like, different sets of values. Louis McNeice talks about it very eloquently, I think. And we read black where the others read white. His hope, the other man's damnation. Up the rebels, to hell with the Pope. And God save, as you prefer, the King or Ireland. That sums up very much, I think, the kind of culture that prevailed in the 1920s, 1930s. Irish became the official language of the Irish Free State and was introduced into the school system by a man called Owen McNeill, who was from the Glens of Antrim and who was the First Minister of Education in the Free State government. He also was one of the leaders of the Irish Volunteers. The Commission was established in 1925 to promote and preserve the use of the language in the Gaeltacht. And new Irish language areas were set up in the 1930s in County Meath. Very interesting experiment. A bit like, for example, the Israeli setting up kibbutzim, where you would take an area and you would plant or subplant a group of people there in the hope that that particular area would contribute to the overall culture and safety and so on of Israel. Likewise, people were attracted from Gaeltacht areas to County Meath, and they were given tracts of land outside Navan. Now, Navan's about an hour from Dublin, and the hope was that in bringing these people there, that first of all, bring them from Kerry, Donegal, and Connemara, that eventually there would come a kind of standardised type of speech. Instead of people talking in different dialects, that eventually over a period of time, they would all kind of coalesce and we would get one kind of hybrid, if you like, type of dialect. But secondly, also that they would have an impact on the Irish language movement in Dublin. A lot of the people who did come actually couldn't stick it because they weren't used to the fact of there were no mountains, there was no sea. You know, you looked out the window of your house and you had Errigal and you had the Atlantic Ocean. You looked out your window of your house in County Meath and just saw these rolling fields, flat and quite boring. And a lot of them actually did go back to where they originally came from. However, some of them did stay and there is a thriving Irish language community there in a place called Rathcarn or Poilla Gib. Just outside Navan, and it's kind of rather peculiar because when you go to the Gaeltacht, you normally head towards mountains and rivers and sea. Here you're going into lush farmland, and as I say, some of the people have stayed there. In the north, 1911 census, there were roughly 29,000-30,000 people according to that census returns who said they were Irish speaking. But over a period of time, because of the fact that the Irish language had become associated with the people who wanted to destabilise the state, efforts were made to ensure that the language was not promoted. I'll just put it as neatly as that. And unfortunately, there were kind of negative attitudes towards the Irish language in the northern state up until the 1970s. Census returns from 2011 point out that in the Republic of Ireland there are roughly about 1.3 million people who say they speak Irish. In the north of Ireland, Northern Ireland, there are roughly about 10% of the population or 11% of the population who say they speak Irish. Whether that's true or not, I'm not too sure, because people say all kinds of things when you're boned by somebody in the street or at the door, or you're asked to fill in a form. Yeah, fill it in, get rid of it. Can you speak Irish? Yeah, I can say the Our Father in Irish, but I can speak Irish. So we don't really know how true some of these census returns are. However, the language has, over the last while back, become more acceptable. Now, okay, I'm not going to talk about Gregory Campbell or anything. That's his problem. But over the last while, it has become more acceptable. Good Friday Agreement, the Belfast Agreement, Strand 3, Paragraphs 3 and 4 says, the British government will, in particular, in relation to the Irish language, where appropriate and where people so desire it, take resolute action to promote the language, to facilitate and encourage the use of the language in speech and writing in public and private life where there is appropriate demand. In the year 2001, the British government ratified the European Charter for Regional or Minority Languages, thus giving some kind of protection to the Irish language. The Southern government has not done that, by the way. So in other words, official attitudes towards the language have changed. We've come a long way from the time that Lord Craigavon, or Viscount Craigavon, said in 1936, what use is it to us here in this busy part of the empire to teach our children the Irish language? We do not see that these boys being taught Irish would be any better citizens. Although the aspiration to totally revive the language has not been achieved, there are distinct hopes, signs of hope. More people from all walks of life and from very political backgrounds seem genuinely interested in wanting to know about and learn the language. And this is no small way due to work done by, say, the Gaelic League or Conan na Gaeilge, or Gael Lynn, or Glóir na Gael, or Clonard in Belfast. And just have a look at the next slide. Just look at some of the things that have happened over the last 30, 40 years. 1971, we had the first Irish medium school set up, Bunscoil Phobail Phearsa. There were 7 kids in it. There are now 5,000 children in Northern Ireland who are learning through the medium of Irish. There are 86 schools. That includes Níosculna or nursery schools, primary schools and secondary schools, where the instruction is through the medium of Irish. So at this present time, there are kids learning their science or their mathematics through Irish. The only thing that they actually learn through English is English, because that is normally the pattern. You learn a language through the language that is spoken. 1972, we had Radio na Gaeltachta set up. That was set up as a result of protests that people, particularly in Connemara, were complaining that there wasn't enough Irish on radio stations. And this Radio na Gaeltachta was set up, which is still very much in vogue, very popular. At the present moment, I think there is a program called Unseal Yas, which is coming from Kerry, and that has just followed a program from Donegal, which has just followed from a program from Connemara. And then in the afternoon, there'll be various music programs. Some of the music is very, very good if you're interested in traditional music. Some of the music is a little bit esoteric. You get things from Tehran and Uzbekistan and places like that. Well, we also have Radio Fáilte, which is here in Belfast, and then Dublin Radio na Liffey. 1991, you've got Cultural MacAdam Ophir, that is the cultural centre on the Falls Road. 1996, we had the establishment of Teilifís na Gaeilge, which is now TTA Ceathair. Again, if you're interested in music, there's some very good music programmes now. Then 1999, we had the establishment of An Forest Teanga, which is set up as a result of the Good Friday Belfast Agreement. And other than Forest Tanna, we get Forest na Gaeilge or the Board of Ulster Scots. These groups are funded by DECAL, the Department for Culture, Arts and Leisure, and from Unrin Alian Eirik Douglas Culture, Agus Gaeltachta. I nearly made a Freudian mistake there. I nearly put in the word culture, meaning culture, but as a friend of mine who worked in that, works in that department said, we got rid of the culture some time ago. We couldn't afford it. Then we have set up in year 2000, Cóilín na Gael Scoile Eochta, which is a group to promote the use of the Irish language, to promote Irish language schools. In the south, you have 1973, you have Gael Scoile. Then in the year 2003, you have Act na Gealltacht Oifigeolaí, the official languages act in the south, and you have a Commissioner Teanga set up. The last Commissioner Teanga, he retired, or he resigned because he said the government was not putting its money where its mouth was and was not doing enough to help to promote the language. Then in 2010, you have a strategy Fiche Bliain don Gaeilge, a 20-year strategy for Irish by the southern government. Then you have the Skynos venture here in East Belfast and Turris, which is their Irish language programme. And then you have recently, 2014, you have Tourish.ie, which is an Irish language online newspaper, and you have things like I Gaeilge or Mion Eile or an Tourish Score or blogs of various sorts. And just last weekend there was Iriachtas na Maol, which is a huge festival which is held once a year, normally in the Gaeltacht. This year it was held in Killarney. And that's where people come together and they're dancing, singing, storytelling, competitions of all sorts. Many people go to them simply because they go because they know somebody from a particular area, they haven't met them for a year, and it's a place where people actually can establish old relationships. You might be justified in asking why bother learn Irish at all. Speak English. One possible answer is that in learning any language, we not only learn words and grammar and pronunciation, but we get a perspective, another perspective on the world that we live in. You know, it's kind of like a patchwork quilt. And by knowing more than one language, we have a better appreciation of that patchwork quilt. With the languages Irish and English, we have two ways in observing, commenting on, thinking about, and understanding our human condition. Seamus Heaney, you've probably got by now that I'm a Seamus Heaney fan. Seamus Heaney, a poem called Terminus, where he talks about being brought up in South Derry and where there was a farmyard, but down the road there was a factory. So he was brought up in between the two. And this is what he had to say. Is it any wonder when I thought I would have second thoughts? Two buckets were easier than one. I grew up between two. So having two languages gives you a sense of equilibrium or a sense of balance. And just to finish off, last week or the week before last, Lula Nigón, a poet from, well, I was going to say a poet from West Kerry. She's not actually from West Kerry. She's from Lancashire, but her parents moved to West Kerry. She was brought up then in West Kerry and she married a guy from Turkey. So she's totally confused in the sense of English, Irish, Turk. She has a poem about Moses and the basket. Now, you know the story that the Pharaoh had dictated that all firstborn sons were to be, all Israeli firstborn sons were to be executed because he was afraid of the fact that the Israelis were, you know, producing kids far too many and they would be a threat to the Egyptian state. Moses' mother took Moses, put him in a basket, and sent him down the river in the basket in the hope that somebody would find him, would take him in, love him, and bring him up. Of course, who found him but the Pharaoh's daughter? The poem is called Cés na Teangmhin, and it's from a book called Pharaoh's Daughter by Nuala Ní Gonal. Cuireann agóthas ar snáil i mhaidín teanga, faoi mar lucha naonán i gléalmhain, a bheith fitse fuitse de gulaga felistrum, is pitchman is pitch, bheith cimmelte bin a hóan. An son é a lucha si is a más na nilcach, is cedil na man si, le tíu na hauan, fecint nadarish, cadoro an suche, feckins dada wisha an wore nain orin. The language issue. I place my hope on the water in this little boat of the language, the way a body might put an infant in a basket of intertwined iris leaves. Its underside proofed with bitumen and pitch, then set the whole thing down amidst the sedge and bulrushes by the ridge, by the edge of a river, only to have it borne hither and thither, not knowing where it might end up, in the lap, perhaps, of some pharaoh's daughter. So, I finish you with a sense of hope. August Martyrmid, Shinnawill. That's it.